This is the 41st session of the debate stage hearings, and I'm going to dispense with the introductions this evening because we want to gain every minute we can, and because I'm sure most of you know everybody and everybody else, at this time. And we're continuing, of course, this evening with the third major issue area, nuclear power in Ontario, and particularly with the examination of the AECL submission, which was presented yesterday.
I would now like, with your permission, to follow a line of questioning regarding reactor safety generally. Could you explain, just for the purposes of clarification, Mr. Pease, what is meant by the phrase uncontained meltdown with regard to reactor safety?
Mr. Chairman, I don't know who has used the phrase uncontained meltdown. It's not one that I have used and I would decline to define it.
Could you, the man I'm thinking of who used it was Dr. Alvin Weinberg, head of the Oak Ridge National Laboratory, speaking in Salzburg, Austria, to the International Atomic Energy Agency. Speaking in Salzburg, Austria, to the International Atomic Energy Agency's conference on the nuclear fuel cycle. What about the word meltdown, Mr. Pease?
Mr. Chairman, I did not hear Professor Weinberg, did not hear his address. I assume that what he meant by the term was described in his report. I would hesitate to comment on that.
But yeah, I'm sure you know what's meant by meltdown.
Well, strictly, Mr. Chairman, the term meltdown in documents as I've seen it can mean quite a range of things, ranging from the centerline melting of fuel elements most at risk, on the one hand, which does not have any significant consequences at all, even to the plant, to, on the other hand, I suppose the one would have to agree that the literal term of meltdown is exactly that, a meltdown. Now, having said that, I think that the natural question is, well, are these things possible? And, of course, this is a question which has been posed to reactor designers in many jurisdictions, not the least ours. And they have given answers, which are matters of public record.
Has Atomic Energy of Canada Limited ever undertaken a study whose objective was to determine whether or not an uncontained meltdown, such as I'm describing, or something which, let me, for the sake of discussion, define what I mean by an uncontained meltdown. I mean a melting of a very large portion of the core, sizable portion of the core of the reactor, which, by one means or another, results in breach of containment and consequent dissemination of radionuclides to the environment. Whether that's through explosion, whether that's through melting through at the bottom, or whatever other mechanism. Has Atomic Energy of Canada Limited ever undertaken to conduct a study specifically aimed at determining whether or not such a uncontained meltdown is possible in a CANDU reactor?
Mr. Chairman, now we're getting to questions that are getting out of the airy-fairy, if I may say so, and perhaps something that I can answer in concrete terms. It is one of my responsibilities, or responsibilities of my group, to theorize about the consequences of various hypothesized events. Now, clearly, I think, Mr. Chairman, you'll gather from my answers to the previous question that we have not theorized about hypothetically uncooled situations in hypothetically strong boxes with too much leak heat. We have, as part of this exercise, looked at the consequences of emphasize.
Can you speak a little louder, sir? These people are missing everything you're saying. All you got to do is just raise your voice a little.
I see. I'm very sorry that you're missing everything I'm saying. It's so great.
You mentioned gaseous radioactive isotopes. You're referring here to radioactive substances which are produced in the fuel as a result of the nuclear reaction in the form of gases. Do you have any figure to give us as to, in one channel, one of the 390 channels, how much radioactive gas there is to be released?
Mr. Chairman, I don't have that figure at my fingertips.
Does 16,000 curies of iodine-131 and 16,000 curies of iodine-131, which is a radioactive form of iodine, and 60,000 curies of noble gases, radioactive noble gases, does that sound right? I got it from the safety report, Bruce safety report. So I presume it's roughly equivalent.
A single channel?
Single channel. But that's a maximum rated channel.
If you got it from the which safety report?
Bruce.
It doesn't matter, any safety report, it's probably a good figure.
It would be good for Pickering as well, as Bruce likely, would it?
No, it won't be quite the same.
It would be a little less.
I think for the purposes of your argument, it may not make any difference.
What does it mean, in terms of practical experience, to say that a large pipe will fail, has a probability of failure of 1 in 1,000 reactor years? What does that mean?
I believe the meaning is plain enough. A large reactor plant has piping in it. We infer on the basis of evidence of failures that have occurred in piping built to this kind of quality in power plants, that the rate of failure is thus and so. We know how much pipe we have in it, and we estimate that the failure rate, 1 in 1,000 reactor years.
What I'm trying to raise as an issue here is that statements having a veneer of scientific fact, such as statements of probabilities, are put forward very frequently and seem to be accepted at face value. And I'm wondering whether anybody in Canada seriously challenges where these figures come from, what the database is on which they're based. And I'm wondering in particular whether the decision makers and the general public to whom these documents are addressed understand what those probabilities mean in terms of actual operating experience.
Mr. Chairman. Dr. Edwards asks whether anyone in Canada, and obviously we've got nine of them right here at least, and maybe others, question the basis of these numbers. We have documents which describe the basis of those numbers.
They're available. It's not necessary that you repeat to the chairman what the question was, because we heard it. If you just go right to the answer, I think maybe you'll get away from hearing it. Keep repeating the question, and it's not necessary.
Well, I recognize that perhaps I'm repeating the question more than I should. Some of the questions, I'm sorry, I must repeat.
Mr. Pease, you say that the documents upon which the basis of these calculations, such as 1 in 1,000 reactor years for large pipe failures, are available. Would you make such a document available to me so that I could see where the 1 in 1,000 figure comes from?
No. One such document referenced in a report by Gibbons and Hackney, Survey of Piping Failures for Reactive Primary Coolant, and it's General Electric Report, GEAP 4574, May 1964.
Is this dealing with the Candu reactor, sir?
Of course not.
I would like you to comment, Mr. Pease, on this quotation from the quarterly technical report for the first quarter of 1976, put out by Ontario Hydro, dealing with the Pickering Generating Station. Quote, during a routine airlock check on March the 9th, the outer door seals of the pressure relief duct personnel airlock were found deflated.
The pressure relief valve?
The pressure relief duct personnel airlock were found deflated. The equalizing valve was open to the relief duct, thus establishing a 15 square inch path to the atmosphere. The The locking pin had not driven fully up. When manually assisted, it completed its travel, allowing the seals to inflate. The probable duration of the fault was 3 days, as it was last used on March the 6th. Now, would this constitute the kind of maximum loss of containment that you're describing? In terms of, that's one penetration being open to the atmosphere?
I think the maximum loss of containment that I am describing is rather bigger than that.
Somewhat bigger?
Sorry, the loss of containment is bigger than that.
Would it be twice as big? Or five times as big?
Mr. Chairman, I don't remember the number exactly. Mr. Edwards, I think you've worked it out. The diameter of the ventilation duct in question is somewhere around 10 or 12 inches. Somewhere around 10 or 12 inches. So this will give you the order of magnitude. I might remark, Mr. Chairman, that... I'll just let it go.
Mr. Pease, in view of this particular incident in 1976, where there was an opening, I understand, through the containment to the atmosphere of 15 square inches, which existed for 3 days, how does this fit your description of the probability of such a thing as being 1 in 1,000? And I gathered from the tenor of your remarks that this meant that it was more or less incredible, that it wouldn't likely happen.
I assure you, Mr. Chairman, that particular event is considerably less than 1 in 1,000 now.
Again, on March 16th, the same report says the lower seal was found deflated. This was after the March 9th event.
And the question? I assume you're reading from a report, and I take that to be a statement of fact. I'm not familiar with the facts.
I could enter these reports if you like.
You've read from it.
Yes.
We'll be doubting the statement.
I'm getting around, Mr. Pease, now to discussing what you wanted me to discuss earlier, which is the probabilities associated with these failures. In 1973, in the fourth quarter technical report on the Pickering Generating Station. Unfortunately, these are the only two that I have ever gotten my hands on. I wish I had them all, but it's difficult to get this information. 1973, the fourth quarter report, indicates that there were similar losses of containment. Well, I'll read it. Losses of containment occurred 4 times in the quarter as a result of airlock door seal failures. Misoperation of the airlocks, particularly
airlock.
During...
As
Sorry.
A result
when,
of
when, airlock,
when you read, doctor, you speed up.
Thank you. Airlock door seal failures.
Thank you.
There's a hiatus there. Misoperation of the airlocks, particularly during maintenance, has been a continuing problem. 3 of those particular events of loss of containment occurred in the month of December. Once again, what I'm getting at, I guess, Mr. Pease, at this moment is I wish you would clarify for my benefit and for the benefit of the Commission where these probabilities come from. For example, you indicated earlier, I believe, a probability of 1 in 1,000 reactor years that you would have a major pipe break or a major loss of coolant. Could you explain in some detail where that figure comes from? How do you know that the probability is less than 1 in 1,000 years, since presumably we haven't had large pipes for 1,000 years?
Well, Mr. Chairman, I am not able, off the top of my head, to recall the contents of the basis of those numbers. But those numbers are derived from power station experience and are as nearly factual as anything that we can get on the probability of failure. As you recognize, Mr. Chairman, and as every designer and engineer in this audience knows, the primary system is designed not to fail.
Mm-hmm. Discovered on March 9, 1976, they figure the probable duration of the fault, since they don't know, was 3 days, and presumably it could have been more than that, but they estimate that it was 3 days since it was last used on March 6th. Now, I figure that if you take a quarter of a year, which is, let's say, 31 days in a month, that works out, as far as I can figure, to a probability of 1 in 40, not a probability of 1 in 1,000.
Well, Mr. Chairman, that is, for that containment, for that year, that is fact. The availability of that containment, in the way in which availability is determined, is less than 999 in 1,000.
Would you then agree, Mr. Pease, that it is misleading to represent low probability, such as 1 in 1,000, as indicating that such an event is just not going to happen, or that it's just rather incredible that such an event should happen? Rather, what it does is it tells you something about the frequency with which it will happen. Is that correct? So I would gather then that when you talk about the probability of a major pipe break as being 1 in 1,000 reactor years, this means that if you had 1,000 reactors operating, you'd have a major pipe break once a year.
1,000 identical reactors, yes.
And if you had 100 reactors operating in Canada, you could expect a major loss of coolant in the sense of a major pipe break once every 10 years.
No, I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, and I should have picked this up the first time. The frequency of major loss of coolants would be rather less than that.
I'm using the 1 in 1,000 figure.
The 1 in 1,000 figure. At that level, that would include pipe failures of all kinds, including small ones.
I'm sorry, Mr. Pease, but my reading of the Bruce report indicates that a major pipe rupture would occur with a probability of about 1 in 1,000 reactor years, but smaller loss of coolant accidents, smaller pipe breaks would occur with much greater frequency. It says, and I'll just quote these two, several spurious outdrives of adjuster rods, I guess those are what we would call control rods, were observed during the quarter. On February 5th, AA15, code name, moved out of the core more than 85 centimeters. That's quite a distance. Resulting in a computer-initiated power reduction to 88% full power. On February 19th, both AA1 and AA15 withdrew from core. Just lifted right out of the core. March 22nd, AA3 drove out about 50 centimeters. No, this is still quoting. No cause has as yet been found for these spurious outdrives. You mentioned an event tree. Could you explain briefly what an event tree is? And in the case of the Rasmussen study, do you have any rough idea of how large the event tree would be?
In the case of the Rasmussen study, I would not have an idea of how large the event tree is.
Could you explain a little bit about what an event tree is? I gather that it's a schematic device for representing complicated chains of events where one event may lead to another event, may lead to another event, and thereby precipitate an accident. Is that correct?
Not necessarily precipitate an accident, but
in the case
a consequence, whatever it was. The consequence might be no accident.
And are you familiar with the methodology by which Rasmussen arrived at his probability numbers?
No, Mr. Chairman, I was asked this before. I'm not familiar with the Rasmussen methodology.
The technique of multiplying probabilities in a very large fault tree, event tree, he calls it a fault tree, was in the space program found to be quite unreliable and led to results such as the following. A rocket engine, which was calculated to fail once in every 1,000 startups, in fact failed 3 or 4 times in every 100 startups. Dr. Bryan testifies that the National Aeronautics and Space Administration rejected the technique that has been used by Norman Rasmussen in the Rasmussen report because it simply did not give realistic answers. And the indication, in summary, was that, well, I quote here, Chairman Warren asks to explain fault tree analysis and asks if there's any use for fault tree analysis. Do you get good numbers out of it, in other words? And Mr. Bryan answers, only for comparison. The absolute value of the number is totally meaningless. There is just no way that number can mean anything in terms of the real-world probability of failure. And he does also specifically refer to the Rasmussen study.
The fact that these probabilities are non-multiplicative,
yes,
non-product, suggests, of course, that there is interaction or interdependence,
yes,
between some of the events.
Yes.
So that's the thing you're pointing out.
Yes, that's what I'm pointing out, that mathematically speaking, one multiplies probabilities when two events have nothing whatsoever to do with one another. They're said to be probabilistically independent. If there is some logical connection between them, whereby the outcome of one event may influence the probability of another event, you then do not multiply probabilities. What I'm trying to raise here is the question as to whether, in the first place, it is appropriate for Atomic Energy of Canada Limited to be taking figures from American reports which have nothing to do with the CANDU design and passing them off without qualification as if they pertain holus bolus to the CANDU situation. And secondly, that despite their emphasis on talking about frequency of events as well as consequences, that they in their charts really only talk about frequency of events and not detailing the consequences. Could you please give us a ballpark figure as to what the consequences of the worst accident Rasmussen talks about is? What are the consequences of such an accident in terms of public health and in terms of property damage?
Mr. Chairman, I cannot put those off the top of my head, but they are a matter of record.
Does this sound right? About 45,000 to 50,000 radiation illnesses within hours after the release, of which about 3,300 would die. About 45,000 fatal radiation-induced cancers over a period of 30 years following the accident itself. About 170 genetic defects per year among the children of those exposed to radiation, and property damage which hovers around the $7 billion mark. I understand that's been increased, mostly due to radioactive contamination of land, food, and water supplies. These are figures which I have to admit, not owning a copy of the Rasmussen report, which is very expensive, I understand the Atomic Energy Control Board doesn't own one either. These are figures which I have taken from the Fox report from Australia, where Justice Fox gave these figures as the consequences of the worst case accident considered by Rasmussen.
Did you quote us Rasmussen's probability of that accident?
You quoted it here.
Well, I don't have the probability right here, but I understand
accident.
It's about... This is the probability of which Mr. Pease was referring to earlier. I think you mentioned...
I don't think that's
the
same accident that Dr. Pease was talking about. Perhaps we...
Well, yes, I think it is. It's the worst case accident.
Mr. Chairman, another report has been referred to, the Fox report. I'm not familiar with that report. I regret that I do not have the Rasmussen report here in order to answer the question factually. If Dr. Edwards knows what the Rasmussen report says, I suggest that he read it into the record.
Mr. Pease, would you quarrel with any of those figures right now in terms of saying that they sound wrong?
I won't comment on those figures because what you have told me is the event frequency.
During his talk, Dr. Weinberg indicated that according to his calculations, by the year 2020, using Rasmussen probability calculations, and using his calculations as to the world's energy needs and how much of it might be supplied by nuclear energy, we could expect one uncontained meltdown every 4 years on the average.
Mr. Chairman, did I hear that? No, I can't say that I did hear that. I assume that this is a statement of fact.
Can you speak up, please?
I did not hear the comment that... I did not hear Mr. Weinberg's address.
He quoted the Rasmussen figures and said that this gives one every 4 years. meltdown, uncontained meltdown, every 4 years as an expectation. He also pointed out that under those same circumstances, we would be reprocessing and processing 100 tons of plutonium per day, and went on to say, such a world is not simple. I'd like to ask you if you are aware of the many accidents, mishaps, foul-ups that have been associated with separated liquid fission products.
I know of some, yes.
And I would ask you in particular if you are aware of the report which was made, it was learned just last year that a major nuclear accident occurred in Russia in 1958 near the town of Lagovashchensk, which I have the spelling of, in the Ural Mountains. Dr. Zoraz Medvedev, who is now living in London, England, and who is a Russian biologist involved in the cleanup operations, said that the accident was caused by an explosion of a nuclear waste dump or a reprocessing plant involving liquid waste such as will only be produced by reprocessing. He wasn't sure whether it was a nuclear waste dump or a reprocessing plant, but he said he was sure that it was not a nuclear reactor. Quote, this is a quote from Dr. Medvedev. Towns and villages were not ordered to be evacuated until symptoms of radiation sickness appeared. Tens of thousands of people were affected with radiation sickness and hundreds died. The true figures were never disclosed.
It's an article in the Science.
Now, once again, I ask you, Mr. Campbell, whether you do not think that this kind of an accident indicates that the public health and the public danger associated with reprocessing nuclear waste is not widely regarded as being much more potentially hazardous, both to human populations and to non-human populations of living things.
You've changed the question that you were posing, Mr. Edwards. You asked me about the relative difficulties of the technologies involved, become a question about the...
Mr. Campbell, that was your interpretation.
Oh, well, I'm sorry that
I prefaced my remarks, if you recall, by saying that trying to separate the technical aspects in terms of a technologist fiddling with machines and getting something working from the public health and public risk questions. And I clarified my question at the outset by saying, in terms of public risk and public health consequences, would you not agree that, et cetera?
No, I would not agree, Dr. Edwards. It seems to me that my statement stands that these are both difficult technologies, but that on the advice of most scientists with whom I've spoken, it is no more difficult to perfect the reprocessing technology than it was to master the original control of fission.
Mr. Campbell, would you say that this incident in Russia, which did contaminate many hundreds of square miles, which are still contaminated and off limits to people traveling through that area, would you say that this is an acceptable risk?
I'm sorry, I don't even... I've never seen an authoritative report other than a newspaper report of the episode you're describing, Dr. Edwards.
It has been confirmed by the CIA, the Central Intelligence Agency of the United States.
That something happened.
That there was widespread radioactive contamination.
Not in fact that the incident, as you described, happened. We have, in fact, tried to get details of this from the Russians and have been unable to. To do so, we will continue to try.
I do not have in my possession, but I have sent away for a report prepared by the German government having to do with the theoretical consequences of an accident at a reprocessing plant. And from my limited knowledge of it, I saw a copy very briefly in Salzburg, Austria. It indicates damage which is far in excess of any of those reactor accidents which are postulated in things like the Rasmussen report. So
that's very difficult to believe.
Well, I don't have that document and I cannot enter it in evidence at the present time, but I'll be very glad to provide the commission with a copy.